For almost 70 years during the 20th century, Eastern Europe, Central Asia and modern-day Russia all made up one global power, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, also known as the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union was involved in almost every significant historical event after its formation in 1922. After its collapse in 1991, it left behind 15 independent countries, several disputed borders, as well as countless tribal conflicts. To see the full picture of how the expansionist world power collapsed under its own weight, let's look back at how they became such a large power in the first place. The Union's founding dates back to the Russian revolutions during the First World War. The February Revolution in the Russian Empire in 1917 saw violent demonstrations in Petrograd and Moscow, and on March 12, much of the Russian army mutinied to join them. Fighting between the monarchy's loyalists and the revolutionists saw the Tsar Nicholas II overthrown and imprisoned, mostly due to loyalist soldiers being stationed on the Eastern Front. A provisional government was put in place but continued participation in the First World War despite public opposition. The revolution in October saw the Bolsheviks take power under the rule of Vladimir Lenin, who signed an armistice with the Central Powers to focus on what was now a civil war in Russia. During the war, many nations managed to secede from the Russian Empire, but following their victory, the Red Army took most of these countries back to install communist governments before merging them to create the Soviet Union in 1922, consisting of Russia, Belarus, Ukraine and the Transcaucasian Republic. The death of Lenin in 1924 saw Joseph Stalin become General Secretary of the country's only party, the Communist Party, making him the Soviet Union's de facto leader. Stalin would commit mass atrocities with his dictatorial power, carrying out mass purges against political opposition, invading Soviet neighbours, vastly increasing the use of forced labour camps known as gulags, and committing genocide against millions of ethnic Ukrainians by starvation known as the Holodomor. Stalin carved up the land in Central Asia into five more separate Soviet republics, and the Transcaucasian Republic was also split into three. Historians see this as being part of a strategy called divide and conquer. During its first 20 years, the Soviet Union tried to expand its influence by installing communist regimes in places like Mongolia in 1924, as well as supporting the Republicans in the Spanish Civil War. Fearful of the rise of Nazism in Europe, the Soviet Union signed the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact with Nazi Germany in August 1939, which was a non-aggression principle between the two regimes. The next month, the Nazis would occupy most of Poland from the west, with the Soviets taking the remainder in the east, as well as annexing Lithuania, Latvia and Estonia, and winning some land in eastern Finland, which along with the Baltic states was all former Russian Empire territory. They then invaded and annexed Moldova from Romania and made it their 15th republic. The Nazi invasion of Poland started the Second World War, and they would go on to break the pact and invade the Soviet Union in June 1941, but the Soviets would eventually push back and capture the German capital Berlin in May 1945. They then started to invade Japan, annexing the disputed territory, setting up a satellite state in the north of their colony Korea, and giving the Chinese communists a foothold in the territory they'd won, helping them eventually win the Civil War. They also installed communist regimes in the Eastern European states they'd taken from the Nazis, including the east of the newly divided state of Germany. The Soviets then began assisting communist uprisings in places like Paraguay, British Kenya and Greece, in an attempt to continue to spread their influence globally. The problem was that the other two world powers who had helped decisively end the Second World War with nuclear weapons were vehemently anti-communist. The superficial alliance between the West and the communists inevitably faded following the defeats of the Nazis and the Japanese Empire, with a rivalry growing between them. The communist uprisings that took place across the world were swiftly ended by the Western-aided governments. The Soviets successfully developed their own nuclear weapons in 1949 and created an alliance called the Warsaw Pact in response to the West formation of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, created implicitly to stop the Soviets invading Western Europe. These nuclear weapons and alliances were used by the United States and Soviet Union to deter each other from direct aggression for a 45-year period known as the Cold War. The Soviets successfully helped communist regimes emerge, first in North Korea and China, then later Cuba, Angola, and then Vietnam, despite American opposition. By the 1970s, the economies of the Soviet Union and its allies were falling further short of the West's. The secular communist regime which took power in Afghanistan in 1978 would soon come under threat from Western-backed Islamist rebel groups, so the next year the Soviet Union invaded to fight them. With the country involved in unpopular wars and much of its wealth being used to prop up its allies, anti-communist and nationalist sentiment began to grow, especially in the Baltic states and Ukraine. Anti-communist sentiment was also growing in Eastern Europe, as their economies were also stagnating. But as they'd historically done, the communist regimes with the help of the Soviet Union had used military might to stifle any dissent. Following the death of General Secretary Leonid Brezhnev, the next two successors Yuri Andropov and Konstantin Chernenko both died in the space of a year. The Communist Party in the Soviet Union was worried that this portrayed them and the country as being weak on the international stage and looked for a more long-term leader. The 54-year-old Mikhail Gorbachev was sworn in as General Secretary in March 1985 by the party's decision-making body, the Politburo. The Communist Party hoped he would stay in power long-term and strengthen the Soviet image on the world stage. Gorbachev was loyal to the vision of the Soviet Union but was also a keen reformist and hired like-minded politicians to his cabinet. With their help, he began to push his ideals through Soviet politics, like opening up relations with the West, reducing the country's military involvement abroad, and bringing more liberal domestic policies to the Soviet citizens. Gorbachev signed a nuclear disarmament deal with the United States in 1986, began the process to withdraw from Afghanistan, and reduced interference in Eastern Europe. But the biggest changes were domestic. At home, Gorbachev introduced a policy known as perestroika, meaning restructuring, which referred to the economic change of state-run economy to a more free market system. Gorbachev also openly criticised the previous strategies of speech suppression within the country, promoting freedom of speech in the press. He introduced another reform known as glasnost, meaning openness, which gave the public the right to speak their mind openly. Gorbachev didn't want to take apart the Soviet Union while reform it, but his policies of freedom of the press led to widespread scepticism of the Communist Party, with the media digging deep, first into its inefficiencies, then the atrocities that had occurred under its rule. Contempt towards Moscow escalated in Belarus and Ukraine following the Chernobyl disaster in 1986. These events would see a growth in nationalism amongst the republics. Gorbachev also made massive changes to the legislative body within the country, known as the Supreme Soviet of the Soviet Union. The members were unelected status quo politicians and only met every few years, so Gorbachev decided to replace it with a new body known as the Congress of People's Deputies. He made two-thirds of the seats democratically elected by the populations of every republic so they could send their own representatives. The Soviet public became more politically engaged with their new freedoms of open speech and elections, and used this to make the critiques of Moscow heard. Each republic within the Union sent their own representatives to the Congress of People's Deputies in the March 1989 election, from Unionist reformists to Nationalist revolutionaries. With more freedom to speak out against Moscow, the stage was set for further exposure of the wrongdoings, mostly under Stalin, that the Soviet Union had covered up for so long. In November 1988, the former head of the KGB, Viktor Chebrikov, visited Estonia to warn the recently sworn-in leaders of the danger of declaring sovereignty. The governing body, the Estonian Supreme Council, ignored the threats and voted to declare sovereignty a few days later, but not full independence. Estonia wanted economic independence as well in order to regain control of its monetary system and move towards a free market, which wasn't possible under direct communist rule. So in June 1989, a group of Estonian deputies proposed investigations into the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, the non-aggression agreement signed between the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany in 1939. The Baltic states, including Estonia, had been forcibly annexed the year after by Stalin. These republics sent the most outspoken representatives to the Soviet Congress and began their attempts to end Moscow's reign and push for investigations into the circumstances under which they were annexed. Keen to stick to his principles, Gorbachev approved of setting up a committee for the investigations, as did the new Congress. A secret clause within the pact had been agreed, giving the Nazis free rein in the majority of Poland and the Soviets free rein in a small part of eastern Poland, as well as Moldova, Finland and crucially the Baltic states. After the Nazis broke the pact in 1941 before being occupied by the four main world powers in 1945, Stalin was keen to avoid the secret being revealed. Hitler had already committed suicide by the Nuremberg trials were held, so Stalin reportedly offered to spare the Nazi foreign minister Ribbentrop from prosecution if he denied the existence of the secret clause. Ribbentrop refused and was the first Nazi official to be hanged. Nonetheless, the Soviet Union continued to hide the truth of the pact anyway until 1989. The committee discovered the collusion with the Nazis, and in June 1989, Estonian deputy Igor Gratzin read out the full clause in front of the Congress, exposing the 50-year-old secret. In November, the Supreme Soviet, another legislative body, passed a law that granted economic independence to the Baltic states, which saw Estonia re-establish its own bank and currency. The Congress then passed a resolution in December, denouncing the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact and officially declaring it null and void. Meanwhile, Gorbachev was losing popularity among the Soviet public, as economic conditions didn't really get any better despite his reforms. But his non-interventionist policies made him popular in the West as he withdrew troops from Afghanistan and ended Soviet meddling in Eastern Europe. Gorbachev likely hoped that Eastern Europe's communist governments themselves would move closer to a democratic system that could be reformed, but instead the communist parties in Eastern Europe lost power completely, one by one. In Poland, free elections were opened up by the communist government, but it was immediately voted out with vocal encouragement for the Polish Pope. Poland's population voted in the right-leaning Solidarity Party in August 1989, who changed the country's name and constitution to steer it westward. In November, the East German government relaxed travel restrictions to West Berlin, and hundreds of East Berliners climbed the Berlin Wall into the west, with some parts of it being knocked down. This symbolised the fall of the so-called Iron Curtain that divided Western and Eastern Europe, and catalysed the democratic transitions in Hungary and Bulgaria from communist dictatorships to Western free markets. In Czechoslovakia and Romania, the communist governments were toppled in separate military coups. Nationalist parties were also elected the next year throughout most of the Yugoslav republics as well, which would eventually lead to that country's collapse. As Gorbachev refused to intervene, almost all the socialist regimes in Eastern Europe began to fall, which got the ball rolling for the same thing to happen within the Soviet Union, and the annulment of the Nazi collision which brought the Baltic states into the Union made it almost inevitable that they would secede. The new role of the presidency of the Soviet Union was created in 1990 and was elected by the Congress of People's Deputies. As General Secretary of the Communist Party, Gorbachev was the only candidate to run in the March election because of Article 6 in the Soviet Constitution, stating that the Communist Party was the only legal party in the country. Pressure was put on President Gorbachev to repeal the article and allow multi-party elections. At the same time, the republics were given the opportunity to elect their own individual leaders, known as the Chairman of Supreme Soviets. The new leaders of Lithuania and Latvia declared independence from the Soviet Union in March and May respectively, which the Soviet Union refused to recognise. Anti-communist and independence-seeking nationalist Boris Yeltsin was elected in Russia. In July, Gorbachev repealed Article 6, ending the Communist Party's monopoly on power, which allowed Yeltsin to resign from the Communist Party and still remain chairman of the Russian Supreme Soviet, which was the head of state in the Russian Republic. In response to their independence declarations, Gorbachev sent Soviet forces into Vilnius and Riga, resulting in a total of 17 deaths. In response, Yeltsin condemned the crackdown and declared himself commander-in-chief of Russian forces, effectively telling them not to take orders from Gorbachev, and he called on Gorbachev to resign and dissolve the Union. In an attempt to legitimise the preservation of the Union, Gorbachev held a referendum in March 1991 to put the question of the Union's future to the public. All the other republics, including Russia, had declared sovereignty from the Soviet Union to bring themselves autonomy, but the other 13 remained within the Union itself. Armenia, Georgia, Moldova and the Baltics didn't take part in the referendum, but all the republics who did voted to preserve the Union. Around the same time, the three Baltic states as well as Georgia held referendums of their own on whether or not to seek full independence from the Soviet Union, and all four republics voted yes, and the same was later done by Armenia. Of course, Latvia and Lithuania had already declared independence, but the leaders of each country wanted a vote to demand recognition from the Soviet Union, who had put an economic blockade on both countries as well as Estonia. Georgia declared independence on April 9th. Voters in the Russian Republic answered another question within the referendum, proposing to create the new position of President of Russia, which would be democratically elected by the Russian people. Most Russians voted yes and again voted for Boris Yeltsin, this time as president, in the modern country's first election in June 1991. The Russian Republic was now sovereign and with its own non-communist president. Yeltsin was a massive Russian nationalist and wanted to dissolve the Union completely and declare Russia as independent, and he encouraged the secessions of the Baltic and Caucasus countries. Fearful of the Communist Party losing power, the party's hardliners attempted a coup on Russia's major cities in August 1991 while Gorbachev was on holiday to restore the party's natural order, but the Russian public resisted the coup. The Communist Party was banned across the republics the next day, then Gorbachev resigned as general secretary of the party that tried to overthrow him, albeit remaining president of the USSR. A few days later, Estonia's council voted unanimously to declare full independence from the Soviet Union. Russia's President Yeltsin immediately recognised the declaration. Declarations of independence quickly followed in Ukraine, Belarus, Moldova, Azerbaijan, Kyrgyzstan and Uzbekistan. The State Council of the Soviet Union was created on September 5th to replace the Congress of People's Deputies, consisting of Gorbachev and the leaders of each republic. The next day, the State Council voted to recognise the independence of the three Baltic states. The next month, Tajikistan and Armenia declared independence, and in October, Turkmenistan followed suit. By December, the Soviet Union only existed in Russia and Kazakhstan, but both countries had their own elected leaders and sovereignty. The presidents of Russia, Ukraine and Belarus, the remaining three founding republics of the USSR, met in Minsk to sign the Belavezha Accords, declaring the 1922 documents that founded the Soviet Union to be null and void. Russia finally declared independence on December 12, 1991, and Kazakhstan did the same on December 16th. The Soviet Union had lost de facto jurisdiction over all of its 15 old republics, but technically there were still doubts over its de jure jurisdiction given that only three republics had denounced the 1922 establishment of the Union. On December 21st, all of the remaining republics except for Georgia signed the Alma-Ata Protocols, which created the Commonwealth of Independent States and saw all the republics formally leave the Soviet Union. Georgia already considered itself de jure independent, but would join the CIS 2 years later. The three Baltic states didn't join and instead opened up relations with the West to eventually join the EU and NATO. On December 24th, the new Russian Federation announced to the United Nations that it was the successor to the Soviet Union and was granted its old permanent seat on the UN Security Council. The next day, Gorbachev resigned as president and declared the Soviet Union, which technically only had de jure authority in Georgia, to officially be dissolved. The hammer and sickle above the Kremlin had been lowered and replaced with the old Russian tricolour dating back to the Russian Empire that had been defeated by the Soviet Union in the Civil War. The geopolitics of the last 100 years have been heavily influenced by the Soviet Union, which is one of the largest empires of modern times, beaten only by the British Empire and its predecessor, the Russian Empire. The legacy of the Soviet Union lives on today in the remaining communist countries that owe their existence to it, as well as in politically tense regions in its former territories that still suffer the legacy of its policy of ethnic cleansing. 26 years on from its collapse, the terror, chaos and tension caused by the Soviet Union is still far from over.
Although the people of Russia gained little, the rulers gained mightily in power. They built up a giant war machine, looking forward to the day when their flag would fly over the entire world. At the time of the revolution, Russia was already a land of vast area. Soon after the end of World War II, Russia had occupied many new territories, bringing additional millions of people under communist control, and serving notice that Soviet Russia was now a world power to be reckoned with.
Прежде всего следует признать, и об этом я уже говорил, что крушение Советского Союза было крупнейшей геополитической катастрофой века. Для российского же народа оно стало настоящей драмой. Десятки миллионов наших сограждан и соотечественников оказались за пределами российской территории. Эпидемия распада, к тому же, перекинулась на саму Россию. Накопления граждан были обесценены, старые идеалы разрушены.
The biggest thing that has happened in the world, in my life, in our lives, is this. By the grace of God, America won the Cold War.